I'd like to start by just kind of going around the table, introducing yourselves, and like I'm going to take this opportunity to shout out one of my favorite movies, Brown Sugar, and ask you guys when you first fell in love with hip hop. So let's start with Robert and work our way around. Tell us a little about yourself and when you fell in love with hip hop.
What's up, everybody? My name is Rob. I use he/him pronouns. I have a background in some shit academically, but I first fell in love with hip hop at the tender age of 7 when I heard Totally Crossed Out for the first time. So it was an innocent exposure to a playful kind of hip hop with the New Jack Swing that I really appreciated as someone that also likes to dance. And used to dance
For
to that
sure.
album as well as to, yeah. And then En Vogue had an album that I'm forgetting the name of it. I have it in my collection, but I used to do the Running Man outside in a house in front of my front steps. And yeah, it just like got me unabashedly in touch with my own body. Like, and I'm just aware of that now, looking back on it. But then it was just a sort of unconscious association with the rhythm of hip hop.
Yeah, just kind of freeing, liberating.
Totally, yeah. So that's me.
Right on, right on. Adam, when did you fall in love with hip hop?
Let's see. My government name is Adam. I go by Dos One. I've been a rapper, music maker for way too long. And let's see. I was a street kid in Jersey, so I was breakdancing on linoleum to the Fat Boys and Raising Hell and License to Ill before. But that was kind of, I wasn't specifically in love with rapping, but that's when I fell in love with like the feel of hip hop. There was no other music basically. Like we were kids, black, Puerto Rican, a little bit of white in the neighborhood, and that was it. There was no other music after we heard that shit. And
It was
yeah.
over. Straight hip hop from here on out.
Yeah, and then like sixth grade, I got really heavily into like lyrics. Like I was really liking rap. And that was like Gangsta and EPMD and Chubb Rock and De La Soul, the first record.
Awesome. Amanda, how about you? Last but certainly not least.
Yes. So for me, definitely growing up, it really started for me with like R&B, like Anita Baker, just like all of that kind of like R&B was filling up the house anytime my parents were playing any kind of music. And then when I was around 5, we moved out to California, and I just remember hearing California Love and just, oh man, that was, it really got me into it, especially being in California at the time. And then coming back, I ended up moving back to Texas, really got into like things like Nelly, all that kind of like the country grammar kind of stuff. Really just like loved it and gave like filled my heart with so much joy. But when I really got into like just like Dos One was talking about, like lyrics, is when I started hearing things like Eminem, and then getting into like even learning about like battle rap and just like people going at each other was for me really later. It was really, I just, Killshot was one of my favorites. I know it's not one of the in comparison to like, no Vaseline or anything like that, or like Ether or even like Sheether, but like me, it was just like the drama surrounding it, like MGK kind of like changing genres. It just brought out so much. And now watching it kind of happen right now again, it just shows how alive hip hop is and how it kind of moves us. And even like, we don't have to turn things to violence. We can say things with words, but man, do those words hurt. Like, we'll cut through you, and it's like, oh, wow. And
I'm
so,
really feeling for Drake right now.
oh, right.
He is just getting murdered.
He deserves, he deserves what's coming to him, though. I will say, this is like the talking to, I wish all these guys that are like above an entire gender and shit like this. This is the kind of sunning they all really deserve, whether it's Kanye or this dude, like, get your shit in line, be creative.
You are so odd.
Kendrick, yeah, Kendrick is killing it right now, actually, as far as like coming at his humanity as opposed to just like taking shots at his masculinity, which is happening also. But there's like he's stepping it up
Yeah,
on a
it's like a
full
very
level.
cerebral attack, and just like song
Yeah, man,
after
it
song,
feels
you can't
good.
even. Yeah, it does. It's definitely good for hip hop.
Agreed.
Yes. Yeah. Kendrick's a different kind of animal, man.
Yeah.
Different kind of beast in that one.
Yeah,
That's right.
yeah. 'Cause I think hip hop lost it. I mean, it loses its way and always comes back. But this was definitely needed. Like it, we just left. Not to just beat up on mumble rap because it's an easy target, but we're in an era where we weren't really caring about lyrics anymore. It was just like almost a disassociative vibe. Like I just want to vibe out and not think about anything. But like, I don't know, hip hop's
I
it's
will
a
say though, over the eras, there has always been a very successful version or two of rap that was lyrically garbaggio. Like, and I mean,
Yeah.
I'll go there and I'll just like Dos Effects is a great version. If you go back and you listen to the first Dos, it's a classic rap record. I love it, but it's accessible to 7-year-olds. It's like all Looney Tunes and like onomatopoeia. Like when you go back and
Yeah.
listen, it's like, dude,
We can
this is like childish, you know. So, and more than it's childish, it's just not amazing lyrics, but
Yeah.
it was platinum, you know. So I think mumble rap is just a modern version of like something that has always been there, which is people who don't have to be. I guess that's also about the
Yeah.
audience. They don't mind not lyrical sometimes.
I kind of first fell in love with hip hop. Like first of all, I wasn't allowed to listen to any rap unless it was Will Smith because he didn't cuss or
Of course.
Christian rap. Like I had this Yo K Carmen Yo MT or not Yo MTV but Carmen Yo Raps. It's just like this. I don't know, like this. It looks like he looked like an Italian nightclub singer, but he was rapping instead. And
Whoa.
he had a little cartoon cat with him.
Wait, is Yo his middle name in this instance? It's
No,
Carmen Raps.
that's the name of his album.
Oh, okay.
Carmen Yo exclamation point raps.
Wow.
Yeah.
He just took the MTV out.
Yeah, pretty much. But
This
like
guy.
I just like for early on I just kind of had to take what I can get and I could sneak it. Like I could watch MTV at my aunt's house or my grandma's, and my dad didn't really care, just as long as I didn't tell my mom that he let me watch MTV,
Right.
but I remember finding this a cassette tape somewhere, and it was Puff Daddy and the Family, but it was Mo' Money, Mo' Problems that really made me fall in love with hip hop. And it's kind of like what you were saying. It's like, I mean, it's lyrically good, whatever. It's not like trash or anything, but it's like it's not a deep song. It's just fun. But like, that's what made me fall like that kind of entertainment vibe and like creating that atmosphere and energy. It's just like, yeah, that's dope. It's like I could see myself in that.
Yeah, I think that's the other thing too, is you zoom out and all genres have a very successful sliver of them that is just horrendous lyrically. Basically like rots your soul, but with fun. Some people, you know, and different people like different things with bad lyrics.
Yeah, it's
I mean,
that's
they
the
want rap good, but they'll take their R&B silly and sexy, you know,
yeah,
too.
sure. It's just That's the beauty of the art form. You know, like you can, it's open to your own interpretation. Once you make it, it's just like we just jump into it. Like we're, take any love song, you know, like we don't know that person that they're singing to. Like we don't have those feelings for them. But like I've had those feelings before. Like it doesn't even matter if it's like sung to a boy or a girl. I can sing Beyonce and like not worry about like how, like I'm just vibing to the energy, you know what I mean? But hip hop wise definitely grew into like one of my favorite songs of all times. And I was listening to your album today and I see you sampled it from Common, but I used to love her.
Oh, yeah, so
Like,
good.
yeah, that's my favorite song of all time. And it's just like still so relevant. Like it just kind of what we were talking about, it tells that story about how hip hop has to grow through these things and to evolve and get to the point
Yeah,
where we are.
that's like a song with a really intense mechanic that's actually written well and good. You know what I mean? Like it's this big allegory for rap, and once you know, it's almost like you most things like that, you can never see them again, like Usual Suspects, the movie. You know, over once you blow the whatever. But it's really well written, timeless. That record is timeless. It's definitely one of the best rap records ever made. It's hard to knock. Resurrect. Yeah.
But just, yeah, just structurally.
And that's a diss song that I never see anybody talking about, but he dissed Ice Cube on a B-side called Bitchin' You. And it is, Common was considered like a, not a fun rapper, but like a more of a De La kind of guy, like a little more flowery and lyrical. And he took Ice Cube's throat, man. And nobody talks about this song. Everybody talks about all these
Gotta
other.
love this dude. It's kind of like Chris Brown, like did a diss track on Quavo, but we're never gonna talk about that because Lamar absolutely destroyed Drake. I feel like it's kind of in that same boat, huh?
You know, you guys are new to this podcast, but we're never really on time with our topical stuff. Like everything's pretty dated, so like we're just gonna keep with that fashion. And I kind of wanted to hear your take on like mostly the whole Diddy situation right now. You know, in hip hop in general, just like your thoughts on masculinity and homosexuality now, because I feel like, I mean, there's it depends on what source you're looking at to see what news and what you're gonna think, what you're gonna hear. But I mean, all like the really like kind of heinous allegations are really not being talked about. And it's just more about this big scandal about how all these hip hoppers were like under the undercover gay and stuff like that. And like they were doing all these wild parties. And yeah, I don't know. I just like, first of all, like, so what? And like, it wouldn't be. I don't know. It wouldn't be a scandal if we didn't make it that way. But it's like, and
Yeah, I
also,
think.
oh, go
Oh,
ahead.
go ahead. No, please. What else are you going to say?
And just also kind of wanted to hear you guys weigh in on it's like, and even with like men wearing dresses in Hollywood and that whole initiation thing is like, do you think there isn't an actual agenda or something to emasculate black men, or do you think it's more us as a culture that are emasculating one another for not living up to our expectations of masculinity?
Man, this is loaded, but I do think so yeah, as highlighted by Diddy being a sex trafficker and abuser, you know, I'm sex work positive, but it seems like he was forcing people to do sex work, all kinds of things, whatever else, you know, I'm sure he has outstanding balances with perfectly upstanding sex workers. A lot of abuse, all that, and really the main concern is like him being gay. And I think that and you brought up, I'm not going to speak on if it is an attack on black masculinity, because for me, growing up in the shitty neighborhoods and coming up in rap, this was always present. and it was in the form of sort of like blanket homophobia that one must work their way through. And generally you do that by having experiences with people that are gay that like denormalize this just constant homophobic lane of masculine expression, which is actually just alluding to weakness. Pussy is another total like hard right turn into just sexism for that one, you know, yeah. When people are just trying to emasculate one another. Mm-hmm. And I think that's because the main currency, especially when you're poor, growing up in shitty neighborhoods, is your credibility and
yeah, right, your absolutely.
And so your masculinity, if this were a video game and you could zoom in, your masculinity comprises a massive portion of your reputation, as is visible, as is by how you perform it. And the only reason I was allowed to present slightly effeminate in any way was because I had pushed one of my edges so far with being a battle rapper. And before that, it was being a fist fighter. But that wasn't something where you could be more effeminate, you know?
Yeah.
You diminished your credit. So I think all these kids are working in some local version of that social, sexual identity related megastructure that is your reputation being this currency and this thing you can't lose, especially if you don't have anything else, you know?
Yeah.
And when I was a kid coming up in rap, they were always talking about who is the gay rapper. I was called gay, but more importantly, there were always rumors about it was Method Man and Red Man. It was so and so and so else. So this has always been going on. And I think the initiation dress thing is another thing that is possibly true, just like someone might be possibly weak being blanketed in just something homophobic.
Yeah.
You know? So like, yeah, they're noticing something. It is not a proper initiation thing. I think that's kind of conspiracy, just like people wondering who is gay and the whole time basically not understanding when I try to teach kids to battle. It's like, if you call someone, ultimately, if you're trying to hurt someone's feelings and you call them gay and they are gay, it does not hurt their feelings. You're basically like seeing them, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like this thing that is not negative in the world. It is not bad. It's actually a relative truth. It just is a shot at people's masculinity and rep. And the whole culture does it. The whole masculine culture. It's not just black. It's not just rap.
Yeah.
These country rock dudes are just as bad, you know. So.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Welcome, Adam Herman. You want to come in cold now? Can you hear me?
How crazy would it have been if I would have been popped in and just like, what's up, bitches?
Hey!
right in the middle of that conversation.
You should have came in real hot.
No, I would never interrupt.
Right on.
What's going on? Sorry, I'm late.
No, it's just heating up.
Good.
Talking about some heavy stuff. Talking about Diddy and all those.
Yeah.
How he's got all these heinous allegations, but like, we're more focused on the fact that he's been gay with all these people the whole time. Like, it makes.
Yeah, I noticed that. That was like the headline. Like, wait a minute. He's doing like awful shit.
Yeah. But like, yeah, we don't want to talk about that. That's weird. I was going to throw it to Amanda and get your perspective on things as a woman coming at it.
Yes. I mean, I'm going to try to kind of keep it contained because, of course, a lot of the heinous things he was doing was to women of color. And it's interesting how all of a sudden that gets obviously kind of pushed aside.
Yeah.
I mean, if we're going to talk about like the heinous things he was doing, he was drugging drinks. This has been proven. His bodyguards are coming out and talking about certain people knew which bottles to take and certain people knew which bottles not to take.
Oh, wow.
Right? Yeah. Like people are, the worst thing is other men were there, other men saw it and nobody did anything. Mm-hmm. You know, there's the human trafficking part of it, of taking a 17-year-old to New York and sexually assaulting her. I mean, it's really gross. But yes, we are very much into the like talking about if he's hooking up with Meek Mill. Like that's the headline. That's what we're talking about. And we can't deny that, like, it's really crappy because so many, as a Black person, I want to say that just in case anyone's listening and doesn't know. It's unfortunate sometimes that a lot of our heroes end up falling into these kind of like our Bill Cosbys and our R. Kelly. But I mean, that we are not the only ones who have, unfortunately, horrible people like that. We have our Epsteins and our Weinsteins.
Absolutely.
A lot of times, because we have so few heroes, I feel like us as a culture feel like we have to hold on to them and then, you know, fight for them. But there's a trail, and I'm sorry if this comes off intense, but there's a trail of Black dead men behind P. Diddy. Like, a big trail of not only men, but also women possibly. And so there, like, P. Diddy did a lot for himself, but did he really do a lot for the culture as a whole?
When
every artist he worked with is either dead or financially in ruins. Like, the only person who made money off of this was P. Diddy.
Yeah. And yeah, everybody's coming out and saying that now. It's just a parade about it. But you made a really, really good point about how few role models we felt like we had growing up. And it's just like, I remember when the Cosby allegations came out, and it was like, how dare they try and take away our hero? He's old. Like, well, like, what the fuck? Like, he's drugging and raping women. Like,
yeah. And it's just really unfortunate. It's very much a power dynamic, because there's a possibility that Diddy was also within this cycle, because Diddy became the VP of Uptown Records at 20, which was very unusual. He was working with Andre, I cannot think of his last name right now, but Andre also worked under Clive Davis, and they feel like this cycle has been continuing, and Diddy is very much perpetuating the cycle of the past. And it's something we learned, me and Rob, we work together, we work with survivors of sexual assault. And something we've learned is, even if a man is sexually assaulting another man, it doesn't mean that he's gay. This is a power dynamic.
Right.
It's all about power in that sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Listening to you talk about it, Amanda, too, another issue that doesn't get focused on just because everyone's focused on who's gay and who's not, is this is a perfect, yet another perfect example of someone wealthy and influential getting away with crimes that would ruin any of our lives. And he has 10 of them. You know, so it's like, it's just like Trump, or, I mean, pick a person at this point. We have dozens of them, and that's actually happening too, but no one's seeing it as that. So it's just, it's like a whole, and then I think too, you know, the model that Diddy's using, people who think about conspiracies think all these people have the same model, but my limited experience, all of these like popular industries, when there's corrupt individuals involved in them and they get influential, they create like a reverse negative safe space for very horrible things. And these people sort of hear about it, and it's a whisper network, and you stay in it. You know, like a lot of actual sex work that isn't lascivious, you know, has to work through whisper network because of the way the world works and how it gets condemned and all this stuff and kink, you know. But these motherfuckers got a dirty version of that, you know. And I wish people were just worried about that. Like, the there's like, that's what you hear about. And I get this feeling that whether it's Epstein or whoever, there's evidence that it exists.
Yeah.
Like the wealthy drastically exploiting people. And there's no
repercussions. Oh, yeah.
And like consent, right? That makes consent very warped, that whole example, you know? Yeah.
Even to going back to Amanda, what you said about how it's he was human trafficking. A lot of times that gets in the news when that part came up, it would get explained away so quick. Say, and he's charged with human trafficking because if you cross a state line, it's technically human trafficking. It just gets kind of explained away as like this way of like downplaying the seriousness of it.
Right. And they don't talk about the fact it was a 17-year-old. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah.
He moved from place to place.
Yeah.
There's pictures. There's so much. I mean, the feds wouldn't show up unless there's evidence.
Yeah. And then being those people that run these sort of things and invite these sort of things, everyone kind of wants to try it, but doesn't want to be seen there. And it's a web. It all feeds into itself. It's like you can understand how humans that are above their own morality, like, or morality in general, would love being totally shitty people to other people in a closed environment. Makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah, and you get away with it for very, 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 very long time.
Yeah, and then what do you do when you get busted? Say you did it? No, of course not. Yeah. It's this whole lie-based, it's darkness, you know? So
yeah, even with, like, Epstein, isn't it wild that, like, all, nobody is getting tried for, like, as the actual, like, Johns, or, like, somebody had to buy, somebody had to purchase the women or whatever, you know what I mean? Like, for Giselle to be on, or whatever her name is.
Giselle. I can't. Giselle Maxwell.
Yeah. Like, she's on trial for those crimes. And, like, but they're not, like, talking to any clients. Like, no.
A deal, right? They made a whole deal. But that was also shady. Like, what? Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, what do you do? I think the thing you can do is, like, update your iOS and know that wealthy people are not out there planting trees. Not all, you know, there's just the darkness in man is totally present. Even if you have $1 million, it doesn't matter.
Oh yeah. They're killing Boeing whistleblowers left and right.
Yeah. Just all that. The evil knows no economic background limitations. It's out there.
Yeah. Like, I don't think money changes you, but, like, it makes you who you would be. If, like, that's why they call it fuck you money. It's like, if nobody could tell you what to do, like, you could do whatever you wanted. And if you're just going to be an extra asshole with $10 million, it's like, fuck yeah. But Rob, we haven't heard much from you.
Taking it all in.
Right on. Take two, stuttering Stanley. Lay some of that insight on us.
Thanks, man. I don't know if it's, insight so much as observation, sure. But it feels to me like, looking at it macroscopically, there's just a lot of undealt with intergenerational trauma that has become so submerged that it has turned into its shadow, you know. And I feel like the hip hop community in general stands to hold itself accountable right now, and quite honestly, just take a moment of silence. Yeah, I'm not at all jazzed about the Kendrick Drake beef, because I have way better shit to listen to, honestly, that is far more interesting. I'm feeling a lot of strong emotion around the audacity of overshadowing this story around Sean Combs with some really petty drama that anybody else within the hip hop community would feel as some schoolgirl should. And it's kudos to Kendrick Lamar for being an excellent rapper and for engaging in a kind of self-reflexivity in this beef, as Adam was saying, that Drake can't accomplish. yet still stooping to a level of personal attack that just seems altogether not what we need right now.
Yeah. You think there's bigger fish to fry?
Yeah. And I'm just like, fuck your beef. Why don't you like advocate for the survivors and your like fellow women identified, you know, femme identified rappers. It's really frustrating. And I think it's endemic or symptomatic of a larger structural problem that, you know, that I think, functions to, functions to suppress and repress people at the site of their sexuality and or gender expression. And we're dealing with that, you know, right, in places like Florida and anyhow, yeah. I'll stop. Yeah.
No.
It's interesting how like there's this strong truth that can be almost, it's palpable that like it's not good for you to be gay and rap, but it's so prevalent that when someone is 10 kinds of horrible person, people are just worried if they're this thing that rap has placed all this stake in worrying about. So you know, I think it's like, and again, they would just, it's about who they choose to have sex and fall in love with. It is not who they exploit or any crime evidence or any, it's really crazy. It's like falling, it's like getting duped by lesser concern. And I think what Rob was saying is really true. It's so endemic and like generational that it just happens automatically instead of the broader conversation and the necessary conversations, mm-hmm. You know? As well as it doesn't just get smacked down and forced to be rephrased, because that's what's really going on. It's like, wait, are you really worried about who, if two boys are kissing, there's all this crime.
Yeah, and then there's even like the straw man of like going back to those conspiracy theories where it's just like, oh, that's Hollywood making them do that. You know what? Like,
well, that's the same. That's a broader, because that saying that Hollywood has a gay initiation rite is not expressly Black culture. That is all kinds of idiot,
yeah.
All color and creeds, right? Uh-huh. So, and that is a vastly, I think, perpetuated by masculine energy and identity. But that's like a lot of people. And so that's just hip hop has its garbage version of the same fear-mongering, you know, and yeah. lack of embrace. I think if, at least in Hollywood, there's prominent, but not like Errol Flynn and all these like famous people that were in the closet their entire career. And in music, you had George Michael almost his entire career, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's still this huge thing, and having to code switch and signal and sing to, pretend you're singing to women and you're not.
Well, a lot of people make a lot of money off of going after people. I mean, like that's half of Wendy Williams is calling out people for being on the DL or being with a trans person. Like, I feel like.
Well, part of that would be healthy. That's actually a practice that needs to happen if it's done in a healthy manner, right?
Exactly. It's not you to make them seem like a bad person, because there's nothing wrong with it.
No.
1000% agree. But there's unfortunately homophobia within a lot of genres of music. But since we are talking about hip hop, I think we can put a light on the fact that unfortunately there's a lot of homophobia and a lot of misogyny sometimes that is really within hip hop, even sometimes with some of our women rappers. Like, I love them, but it doesn't feel like they get to be the Lauryn Hills. It feels like they all got to be like Nicki Minaj. And it kind of just that one image. But I mean, that just might be the way I see it. Which...
You know, we've been teaching kids to freestyle. We're just starting. So we only had day one. After we tell you cool things about rap and rap history and how to rap and why this is artistic, right? There's a quick section that's like, I challenge you to not. And it's basically the no's of like, let's not be homophobic. Let's not be misogynist. Let's not be putting people down, racist, obviously. Because we just had one 12-year-old girl and another woman, there was no need to give that speech. and no one intruded on those lines. So I'm not saying it proves that like men do it, but just it was a very like quick slice of like, whoa, no dudes in the room. And we didn't even have to start with the no before we started doing something. So it's just something to think about. Men are doing it.
Adam Herman, what's
are awesome.
What's that?
I can see why they're choosing the bear. Sorry, Johnny, I interrupted you, dude.
No, that's okay. That's okay. What is your experience with in your genre? Because it's not you're not a hippity hoppiter.
Well, and I'll try and be brief because it seems we got time running out before we have to do a new one.
Yeah, we're gonna have to take a break in a minute.
Not so much with like homophobia, but there is a misogyny to it in the last 15 years I've noticed of like I had to once and I'm very much guilty of it as well, just because it's something that it was just like a world that I jumped into and that's how it was. But once I noticed like my daughter starting being interested in writing songs, it kind of woke me up. I'm like, oh, I need to see more flyers with my name on it that are shared with female writers and female artists and stuff. And it really came from trying to, you know, push her into it and support her. But then you kind of opens your eyes like, oh, and I think that it speaks to why intention is so important in trying to, you know, do these things in the correct way and have a balanced and nuanced approach to it. And you know, once you start seeing female songwriters sharing the space with like your dad, you're going to be more pumped to write music as a female young girl that wants to write.
Yeah kind of takes
it might be just a very simplistic view of it, but that's what I could get in less than a minute.
Yeah that's where it starts. All right, that's a good place to stop. Well, hello out there in Oddville. Good morning, Neverland, and namaste, bitches. Thanks for sticking with us to the halfway point. Today's episode is officially unofficially sponsored by the artwork of John Jason Phillips. Jason's a good friend of mine. He was on the podcast already. I'm house-sitting for him while he's out in San Francisco being honored for a mural that he did about 40 years ago. So if you're in the Bay Area, go check out the world-famous Grub Steak Diner. Then maybe we can afford Zoom Premium and we won't have to do these ads in the middle of our half-an-hour stints. And if you're somewhere else, check out his work at johnjasonphillips.com. And of course, don't forget to subscribe to this podcast. Tell all your friends to subscribe too.
You are so odd.
And you know.
And then so you guys, do you all work together or is it Rob just works with Adam? Is that what I heard?
Rob and I just started working together. We're friends, but we just started working on trying to create a class to help teach kids to rap, freestyle, channel their spark and have an outlet from violence, creativity. But
that's such a good idea. I love it. Like, especially introducing it at such a young age. I was like, I've rapped a bit throughout my life, but I've never been, I overthink too much. So like, I've never been a good freestyler. Like, I can't get out of my head to like say anything. So like, yeah. I think as a child, like something like that would have benefited me greatly. So I think that's awesome that you guys are doing that.
It's really good for how a human holds themselves together, especially when you're young. It's like advanced public speaking. It's improvising.
Oh, yeah. I couldn't do it.
It's, you know, it's a real thing. And I think for these kids, like what I was saying earlier is like about how much your masculinity comprises you being cool or safe or having a reputation, you know, like there's this thing about being creative when you're in the hood, when you're young, and like you can't really say, even if you were painting a flower all day, you can't really come out and say that. One of the few, there's two things you can really do and suffer no coolness penalty. One is rap and the other one is do graffiti. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But graffiti comes with penalty of law. Both of them come with, you know, various gatekeeping and testing experiences, trials, competition, all this stuff. But what I try to like find in these kids is like, if you are struggling with this world only offering you ways to be violent, you can put that exact same intensity into this creative thing and not lose any street cred. You still gotta get yourself out of getting into fights and figure out how to present as someone that's like, nah, I rap now, you know?
Yeah.
The birth of hip hop was gang violence being diffused with breakdancing, you know?
Yeah. And
it was like, nah, let's take it to the stage. It's why battling is so popular and you have movies like Bring It On and, you know, it's like that phenomenon goes back to that truth, you know, and breakdancing and DJing preceded the MC, and the MCing found its form of battling. And now, you know, so it's like,
yeah, in that first legendary party hosted by DJ Kool Herc, you know, they're trying to get away from the bullshit. Like, let's just gather and have a good time. And they just started shouting their friends out over beats. And
I was reading this, I am still reading this book called The Come Up. It's a really great oral history of hip hop. I highly recommend it. And one of those things is all those original parties, like all the people that were there were kids, 16 and under, because the adults would go out to clubs and it was sort of like everyone was broke, but kids definitely had no money and no transportation.
Yeah.
So like the rap was actually kids, man. You know, that's who believed in it. They were like, yeah, this is it. And then eventually it blows up, you know?
Yeah, yeah. What an incredible time in history that we live.
Yeah, that's like, pretty cool. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
We got to witness the birth of something so incredible and just look how many places that it's gone and evolved through. And yeah, I don't know. You can just sit in amazement of it. Like, how lucky are we?
Yep. And everything except graffiti, apparently graffiti was originated. I mean, it was in ancient Rome. You know, people were writing, Marcus was here, but like graffiti was originated in Philly, but all the other forms of expression that rap created was really all the Bronx, you know. The innovators were around the world and everyone gets the credit once they were introduced to it, but who actually, like, it's like this renaissance that nobody talks about. And I think about it all the time, how potent the Bronx was when it manifested all those art forms. And then since then, all we've had is like dubstep. So, House was made in Chicago by Black artists, you know, all the good art forms are invented by, you know, Black culture, which is
a
beautiful thing. But it's interesting. It's really interesting how like all those forms were born in one place. And they're all amazing.
Yeah. And there was, and just talking about like the movement, Adam and I were talking about this on the last couple of episodes, just like those significant moments in time and eras. Like, we had a guest on that was in San Francisco during a artistic boom. And like, but like, there's been so many of those in hip hop. Like, it started in the Bronx, but like Outkast in Atlanta did that. And like down in Texas with a Chopped and Screwed, that was a movement. And like you said, like you mentioned, like when Nelly came out, like that was big to me too, because like I had a lot of family from St. Louis and it was like, oh shit, we're on the map now, you know, we exist.
That's how I felt in growing up in south of Kansas City when Tech N9ne was coming up and he started Strange Music. I was working in a record store when I was 18 and they would come in and I was like, these guys are like the coolest people on the planet. And they didn't acknowledge me at all.
Tech N9ne's brilliant, you know, he really is like singular independent. And he's been around since the way back.
Yeah, I gave him a classic white guy hug once, no big deal.
There you go. What else are you going to do? He's one of the greats.
It was awesome. But yeah, you're right, though, John, going back to your point, it's like you don't you almost don't realize it at the moment when you're, when it's around, that it, that yeah, something amazing is happening. You know, it's only until looking back, you know?
Yeah. Cause it just, I think it just has to be pure and like yep, from love. Like it can't be to get anywhere. Like it's a form of presence. It's like you're in that art and like you get to be, especially freestyling, like you get to be here now. Like you can't really be anywhere else but in that moment. And it's just, yeah, I don't know. Like they didn't make hip hop to blow up. Like it was just an escape that became something amazing.
Yeah. And I think people like to, especially when hip hop was originated, you know, they like to bag on it as not really a music, you know, but they were seeing something clearly the wrong way. And that is that rap is inherently made from scratch. The music, the rapper, the like necessity of it, you know, and not many other art forms are, man. Like punk is a little bit like there's untrained musicians making music in that genre on a high level, you know, mm-hmm, but it's really all about rap, like rap. And that's why you saw in over generations and in different locales, you saw the same like unbridled energy manifest great rap in a group of people, because yeah, that's what started, right? So like without there being a manual that was passed around, motherfuckers just got the gist, you know, and they did it their way because it's built from scratch. So like, you know, some people, when they created their version of rap, instead of doing all samplers, they played some instruments and it helped broaden what rap was, but it was just them doing it the way they could, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's like, it's pretty good. You know, I'm very proud that anyone can rap. Like it's a, albeit misogynistic and homophobic, it does take all comers, you know what I'm saying? You can, you may have to kick the door down, but you can go for it, you know, and you'll be recognized if you do it right, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And it's honest. Like going back to battling again, it's like you can't fake it, you know what I mean? Like you can't get, you, I guess you get lucky sometimes, but like, yeah, it's, I don't know, it's pure.
Well, now though, it has become the most popular thing in the universe, right? Let alone the most popular genre in the world. So you mm-hmm, are seeing the era of those who look the part, but don't necessarily fit all the bills that constitute the artistry.
Yeah.
Okay, that has also always been there. Like, mm-hmm, you know, we're getting called out for like, you're a sellout, you don't really, you're a dancer and you just rap on this record.
Thing happens now, but
just, who are you talking about there?
Whoever, there was a lot of people like that. Buckshot Shorty was a dancer, you know?
Yeah. We were John and I talked about Tupac not too long ago about that.
But now you can just have abs and a face tat and you can fucking go rap adjacent.
Right.
It's all right, you know, it's yeah, how it is. You can't complain about it. You can just take notice, you know?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
do you guys, what, like the mumble rap movement? Are you guys cool with that? Cause I am whatever. I think it's whatever.
When
it's interesting. Because if it is an expression, if it's truthfully an expression, then it's usually probably good.
Yeah, I mean, mumble rap essentially is just sort of like a style of rap almost. Mm-hmm. It still has lyrics and should have rhythm and has some kind of melody or something. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what all rap is like vaguely mm-hmm, doing for you at all times, you know? And when the mumble rap, to me, the only time I dislike it is when it sounds like it's the first take. You know, like, I'm not here for your, like, you shitting out a song.
Yeah.
Every other instance of it, I'm just like, oh, this is pretty loose rhythmically. And then some of it's really good. Like, I don't know where the actual line for mumble rap is, but like.
Yeah, I don't know.
Some of the early stuff is nasty, you know, the stuff that created the genre. Yeah.
I don't know if you invented mumble rap. I don't know much about it myself, but I think Sierra Wag does it masterfully. So shout out Tierra Wag.
Tierra Wag?
Tierra Wag.
Yeah. I can't. I'm sorry. I'm having trouble hearing you.
Oh.
It's not being on my end.
Tierra Wag.
No, it's low. Oh, there you go.
Yeah, there we go.
Beautiful.
But yeah, it's all part of the growth process. Like you first innovate and then people follow you. And then once it becomes a formula, then people just like plug in this and plug in that, and that's when it gets oversaturated. But then that's when hip hop has an opportunity to grow.
Yeah, it's public domain, you know, but so is like fucking figure drawing, and there's still dope figure drawing. Like all the things are public domain, you know? So, and then I think in that regard, you just really are looking for people that are, I guess the new way to say it is cosplaying, but beware all posers and tryhards, and try to attract and understand the real deal when you meet it. And how to be cool with it and not and stop your posture. There's like an amount of posturing that's necessary to succeed in any social environment. And it's important to understand when you drop that guard to actually meet someone who needs to get met, you know? And sometimes they still have their guard up. You don't get to meet them, blah, 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 you know? So it's like it's a weird world, but you know, that's kind of how it is. I think that some of that gatekeeping that's based on healthy competition and pressure is something that is really necessary in all higher forms of everything. That said, that truth being in all these forms is really exploitable by shitty people, you know, and lower standards and
And I think
Yeah.
like for so many, like hip hop is the way they've gotten out of so many horrible situations. So that's why so many other people can exploit the real deals, the ones who are putting their hearts and souls that we never hear from, because they are either, you know, getting taken advantage of by the, you know, the faces, the Drakes, the whoever, because the ghostwriters and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Kind of getting that left behind. That's kind of like what we were talking about, like way back with like what Diddy did, because I feel like Diddy was able to also kind of do that once he got more powerful, was exploit, because he was always, I mean, watch Making the Band. You just saw him
Oh,
exploit
yeah.
seasons of that, like these kids, like forcing them to walk to get him like cheesecake or whatnot.
One of
Like,
the best Chappelle skits.
Oh, yeah.
Ever is that.
It's real
And it's
Cambodian.
pretty accurate. Yeah.
It's
That
a
was my
real.
question, is exploitation. I didn't mean to cut you off, Amanda. I was just
Oh,
interrupt you there. I was
no.
just
That's kind of where I was going with it. Yeah, but like it's definitely, we've definitely seen not only the exploitation of it, but you know, bringing it back to Diddy and kind of like what he did and the things that he's been accused of, is one of them is like having Usher at the age of 13, that Flavor Camp. Have y'all heard about that? The Flavor, Puffy's Flavor Camp?
Briefly, I
No.
didn't hear that it was called Flavor Camp. Like
Oh yeah, it was somewhere.
that's so
Yeah.
creepy.
Right.
Beef was
And
there
Usher
too, right?
was on like Howard Stern talking about, he won't go into exact detail of what was happening, so you have no idea exactly, but you know, just like seeing a lot of things at the age of 13. And how many rappers are we hearing, like Chris Brown talked about at 14 being taken advantage of by a woman.
Yeah.
Jeezy came out not too long ago talking about at 14 being taken advantage of by an older woman. So we see like this exploitation kind of within this whole creative outlet too. That's a little bit scary, especially for people.
You know what's interesting too, and this is not to like take it off hip hop, but hearing it put in this drive a context like that, there's all these kinds of exploitation and predation and confusion. Like, I think it's really just something that is not brought forward enough in society and is actually happening everywhere in volleyball, the plumbing industry,
Oh.
fucking roofing. I don't even know. I think it's actually this thing that is incredibly present, and it's been so. It's one of the few things that I meet a lot of people that have an experience with it, but because it's all kept so under wraps, it's not the experience you get to hear about. Also, it's a difficult experience, but it's a weird thing that everyone has a lot of experience with, but it doesn't resonate outwards, you know?
Sophie.
Like when a bunch of people sit down and talk about, sports, they're sharing all these experiences freely, but this is this really intense thing that everyone has in common that doesn't travel, you know,
And is it
public.
anything to do with like masculinity and how, like, because, like I said, me and Rob work in the field with like survivors and stuff. And a lot of times, young men are can't talk about it and feel like they are not allowed to talk about it, but we know it's happening. And we're just now starting to hear about it as they're grown men. Do we feel like that's something like masculinity kind of holds?
Yeah. I do. I don't know what to say, except so I was a victim of abuse. It wasn't sexual, but it was adjacent, right? Amongst other abuses. And I remember feeling like I've never heard anyone talk about anything like this. So I know I can't, you know. But it wasn't, at least with younger kids, it kind of precedes masculinity. I think when we're talking about Diddy and all this creepy fuckboy mania that's going on and power abuse, you know, that's something different. But I think the masculinity does form it. I guess you kind of, I don't know, my dad, like, they barely give you this birds and the bees talk, man. There's no nuance, at least back then. No, I think it's something that probably hasn't sophisticated too much, you know, so I don't know why. But I remember, so all that to say, yes, that's how it feels. Like, you just can't say it if it's happening. And my friends that I knew that it was happening to, because of a slip or whatever when we were kids, you definitely didn't say it for them. You know, you didn't tell. It's like weird.
I know, right? And a lot of times, like the music too, I feel like a lot of people get their pain out with the music. And it felt like the music of the 90s, we felt that. And then like with the mumble rap era, it doesn't feel like we feel the same. Am I kind of like off base with that?
No, I think I feel you. Like, it doesn't, you mean like it doesn't really resonate with us the same as, I mean, that's, yeah, that's why we have all these 90s and early 2000s parties now, and like all these, it's just nostalgia. Like, but that was like maybe our parents' 70s era. But I don't know, it just, and I've kind of said it before, like, it's just, it's not made for us, and that's okay. But yeah, I don't know, I think the pulse of that, like, we already found our sound, and like, that doesn't mean as we get older we don't appreciate new music as much, but like, we've kind of already know what we have, so we may dabble in mumble rap and stuff like that, but yeah, it's just not all art's for everybody, I guess, and it still should exist.
You're right, because I always on the discover new music, you know, on like spot whatever, if I'm listening to a new artist, I'm like, oh, I like this, and I'll go down the rabbit hole and listen. I'm like, see, and I think to myself, you know, it's pretty cool. I'm 40. I'm still finding new music. And then I'll look and it's like the album was made in like 2009. And I'm like, oh, so, no.
Like, no, I'm just way like late to the party.
He was most recently active in 2012.
But, you know, I'm always discovering new songs my friends have been listening to for years. I'm like, have you heard this? And they're like, God damn.
Like, when we talk about rap being emotional, though, like, I think that's like, it's, of course, it's subjective, but like, there's emo rap, which is like brazenly trying to be emotional, you know? And then I think in rap, though, to me, what always was like, felt emotional when people even weren't being that was when they felt like they had soul. And there's definitely some mumble rap that feels like it has soul. You can hear it, you know, you're like, ah, I can see why kids like this. Have you ever heard some shit like that and been like, nah, I can see why
it's like
they catch a buzz and they put it loud and it feels really good. And that's you're connected with it. And then there's other stuff that's like attempting to be that, or that just makes me it's sort of like just like a Diet Coke version of whatever I would like to hear, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But the good stuff.
It's the Nickelback. It's the Nickelback of mumble rap. It's the Nickelback. Formulaic. It's the formulaic.
Yeah. You know, Linkin Park.
Yeah.
It's bad, whatever it is.
God, Nickelback really got screwed. Like, they're still selling, they're still touring and selling out arenas, like, but everybody says they're ass. But it's like, yeah, that's, they found a niche that people like, and they're More power to them.
Are they the, is that the one that sounds like Creed? And yeah. Then, okay.
Look at this photograph.
Yeah. Dude, the thing is because they were one of the first meme bands. Because they were memed to such a level of everybody thinks they suck, they were allowed to come back. If nobody put them to that level of ironically sucking, they would be gone.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah, someone made like a joke on a late night TV show one time. It was like Nickelback sucks, and it just like took off.
It blew up forever, and it kept going, and it saved their whole career.
Yeah,
I'll tell you what, y'all can say that. You can always can do that to me at any time, whatever it takes.
All right. Oh man, that happened. At least for me, anyways, it happened to Coldplay after 40-Year-Old Virgin. You remember the line in there? It's like, hey, you know how I know you're gay? Because you like Coldplay. And then all of a sudden, like, God, oh yeah, Coldplay sucks.
Coldplay.
But like, I was.
Coldplay's awesome.
I know. I probably like just didn't fuck with them because I heard that. It's like, oh yeah, fuck them. But like later in life, I was introduced to them. It's like, dude, it's fucking, yeah. Chris Martin,
I think though that legit. What we're noticing is there's a point in popularity and success where you become like reflexively completely annoying, and we can wish that on all of our popular enemies.
Yeah,
that quickly hit that point where they become redundant and annoying. Like whether you're Young MC or whoever or JoJo Siwa, you know, like you just become so big that it's a joke. You know what I mean? You were a rising star, but now you're. It's just...
It will never happen to Taylor Swift, though, and no one can besmirch my queen. Never.
That and Beyonce. I love Beyonce.
Yeah,
Beyonce can never do rent. She could do no wrong.
No wrong. But they say they're coming for Jay-Z, you know, in the conspiracy world. If you're in the. If anyone knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, because they're so successful, they must be Illuminati.
Yep.
They're planted there.
Yeah, conspiracy. One of my things that this is, I think this is about like emotional / straight intelligence. But like, when I was young and I got into rap, there was like 5%ism, and you know, a lot of people were Muslim and converting to being Muslim. And then the other thing that was like a quasi religion that was circling it was like conspiracy. Behold the Pale Horse, educating yourself on the Masons and the Illuminati. Mm-hmm. And it was like this sort of like, it was the knowledge and the math of like conspiracy, and rap was very into it. And it was adopted by all who were close to rap, right? But then after a few years, I remember being like, well, yeah, some of this Illuminati stuff is like, you know, interesting details and things like this, you know, but at the end of the day, watching all of these millions of people who are grown as fuck become conspiracy obsessed, whether it's QAnon or any of this stuff, I wonder what learning development they have, because like you were supposed to do that at 16, man. Yo, the sun's really made of chocolate, or like, you know, this is for like I and the young, man. This is not for the old and holding down a job at UPS.
Yeah, you got shit to do, man.
What's going on, man? That you're like connecting these weird dots, flat earthing.
Dude,
like,
they heard a ring come from the moon. Did you guys know this?
No.
The moon's hollow, and it rang like a bell one time, and they heard it.
Oh, I think I did. I think I did hear that at one point.
It is a real thing, but.
Yeah.
But it speaks to that.
I mean, all that to say, it just reminds me of the Illuminati shit and the reptilians. That so-and-so is a reptilian, but so-and-so is not, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
David Icke.
And they say that, like, P. Diddy's in the, like, black sector of the Illuminati. I don't know what they call it, but they say that people who believe in that conspiracy believe P. Diddy's all up in it.
So something for me that made me know there's all this Illuminati stuff that, you know, was supposed to come to pass in the last 5-6 years. It's like vaguely aligned with the Bible, you know, right? Mm-hmm. But that harbinger of all that one world government, one world order, right, was supposed to be Donald Trump. So that made me know there's no real Illuminati, because you don't have a secret society for 1,000 years and then blow it on when you pick a fucking mark. And you know what I'm saying? So it's like, so that goes to say too, what you made me think of earlier, Amanda, was like, Diddy is this example of someone super wealthy and powerful who's like standing outside the law, right? That's what the, if, whether there's an Illuminati or not, I don't fucking know, but there's certainly a gaggle of these very wealthy, powerful people who are above the law, right? And there's dirty cops and there's all the things. So somewhere, conspiracy theory is like an introduction to the a harsh reality, right? You
Yeah.
know? But none of that shit is true. You know?
Well, I was about to say, Cat Williams has also been talking about this for years. And he
Thank you. I didn't know if you brought that up in the beginning. I couldn't wait to bring up Cat Williams. Go ahead.
Yes. Yeah, because I was watching an old stand-up of his. I think it was, well, I can't remember, but he was talking about going to a Hollywood party and people had the door open and they're like, you know, we can see you, right? Like Cat Williams. And just recently, Cat Williams was talking about Diddy and having to tell him no when it comes to partying and stuff like that. Yeah, so I mean, it feels like an open. There were so many open secrets. I mean, what's his name? Weinstein was an open secret in Hollywood too, and he was also doing horrible, horrible things to
Oh
people.
yeah. I
He
can't
was.
even remember what show it was, but probably a couple of them. But like, oh, I think it was 30 Rock. Like they were making Weinstein jokes about like how inappropriate, this is long before it happened or it
Wow.
came out, but it's like, holy shit. Like they were right. Like everybody knew about that and they just kind of made jokes about it.
So, do we think that Cat Williams is somewhat responsible for Diddy getting caught because he blew it up
No,
again? He
like,
brought it back to the cultural zeitgeist, to the center.
well, that's sort of like maybe like Hannibal Buress helped get caught more popular, but I also feel like these cats were filing these suits and
Not
Cat Williams
beforehand,
in them for a sec. You know what I mean? So it's like in that case, maybe a bit of both. I don't know.
Or just like, because I mean, cat's a really smart cat, man. Like,
I'm a huge
perhaps it
Cat
was
Williams fan, yeah.
perhaps just a strategic move, like well timed.
Yeah.
Like, I'm gonna release all this stuff that's coming out anyways, right around the time it's about to come out.
Yeah.
Yeah, like he was in the know already, kind of, that the FBI was. Because
Well,
the
I mean,
timing was crazy, right?
oh yeah, like I think he said it and the suit started happening like right after he
Yeah,
said it.
maybe weeks, not even a month later.
I
Yeah,
feel
so
like
maybe.
there's a, oh, go ahead.
I was
I
gonna
think
say
it's.
maybe they knew something behind the scenes, maybe. It felt like, because he said something about like, I don't know what kind of language you'll have on this show, but he's like, you know, you big dick, whatever, they're coming
Whoa.
So it seems like he was implying that other people are also gonna get, and then now all this stuff is happening with Drake, and it's kind of just ironic, maybe some would say, or maybe Cat Williams is in the know.
Well, I think the cool thing about what Cat is doing is he's at some point in his career, for I don't know exactly what it is, but it's allowing him to say the quiet part out loud, as they say, which would be part of the healing and retribution and accountability that rap itself or rap adjacent energies would take to like make amends and be a little more square with reality. But it's like, so he's actually, because I don't know the reason that multiple people go to these, everyone knows this stuff and they just don't talk about it. And then there's, so what if it's not conspiracy and he's not a soothsayer? He's just literally the only one not scared of saying what he saw at the party. I
Well,
mean,
there's
is that, you know what I mean? That's like crazy.
and nobody has anything on Cat Williams because he's already been through it. Nobody's hiding anything on him. He got in trouble enough times and he's come clean enough times about it. There's nobody holding anything over that guy. He can do whatever
Right,
he
so
wants. And he's
he's
got the
doing something
talent where he's
super.
respected in his industry by everyone. He is
So what would
untouchable.
be cool is if you could talk like that and be honest like that before you're at the point where you have
Yeah.
nothing to lose,
Because
right?
then you're called crazy. I mean, we saw what happened with Dave Chappelle.
Become a crackhead and shit.
Cat Williams did. He like the thing I talked about was way back when I was 10, 15 years ago, and they just went crazy and almost ran him out of the business, and he's finally able to come back because the internet is giving him a platform. They would never give him a platform.
And I wonder if Cat Williams, because he was in an interesting situation, he was in like an interesting position, because he was kind of in that, he was a comedian, so he should be able to be goofy and do comedic things, but he was kind of held to the same level that a lot of like rappers were held at, you know. He was kind of held at this unique I don't know what you would call it. He was kind of positioned in between the both, and I think it was really unfair to, because he was being judged as a serious artist, but he's still a comedian, like he can do goofball shit.
Yeah.
And that brings it back to the conspiracy about the dresses, because that was another place it was brought up, was with comedians dressing up like women, and that was like part of their like Hollywood ritual type thing. And so that also brings that whole thing back to it, because
Dave Chappelle brought it up after they made him dress in a dress. He was in a dress in Robin Hood.
Are they
in his tights?
So the only thing I have to say to that is like, maybe it is a like long-standing mechanism of like emasculating motherfuckers, you know. Maybe it's just like a really long line of, dude, that's what Benny Hill was doing. They were putting you in dresses, and it was kind of funny, and it's weird, and for some other shitty reasons that's funny to people, you know.
It either
is emasculating, but I think it's really basically catering to like a more earlier sexist form of humor as opposed to something else.
Yeah, like the people that have the money and are making the movies, that's what they think is funny, so that's what they're going to pay for. Like if you don't want to do that, then they're not going to pay you to do it. And it's kind of like, it sucks that those people are in positions of power, but it's not necessarily like, I don't think it's like a conspiracy. Cause like you were saying, like back to Shakespeare, like there used to be no women in plays or in acting at all. So you'd have men would be in dresses since the beginning of.
They were a troupe.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah. Go ahead.
When it comes to men in the dresses, I think it's more trying to make Black women look masculine. Black women, they're always playing a very stereotypical, very, you know, ghetto, loudmouth, angry woman. It's never a man in a dress playing like a very like a Michelle Obama or anything like that. Like a very you know, well-rounded woman is always this angry Black woman that they're portraying. So I feel like it has a little bit more to do with like the misogyny and the way that they view Black women sometimes.
I 100%. And
you think Madea is not an accurate representation?
I was just about to ask you, what's your thoughts on Tyler Perry?
Try not to have too many of them. Once again, like, it's very loud. She's going to prison, cutting up stuff, which, I mean, there's very much room for that. There's nothing wrong with that, but it's used in, like, comedy, too. It's to make fun of.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Instead of, you know, and a lot of times, you know, it's single Black mothers who, you know, raised a lot of these men in hip hop, too. And sometimes it feels a lot of like a hatred towards the parent who stayed than necessarily the one.
Oh, interesting.
It is. Misogyny is pretty intense in rap. And like,
I'd love to unpack that whole concept up way more. That's really interesting.
Well, when you're asked to be masculine, like there's not really, even after all these successful female artists, there is not literally a door that is always ajar for feminine energy, or, you know, I think artists like No Name are like expressly feminine and incredibly rare. But most, at least when I was rapping, you project in a masculine fashion, you know, you're kind of ripping MCs up, whatever it is, like there's all this, kowtowing. Yeah. Kowtowing to the masculine nonsense, you know, and Yeah, and that's how it goes. And like even you just sort of see it. That's but I think that there's this weird thing with music where it's like people are actually selling what people are buying. It's not always like that. Most people, you know, it's like there's like whatever they want, they'll add that, you know. Popular has always been looked at as like this gradual cocktail of the coolest things. And when you do that, you make a mess.
Well, shit, man, I hate to everybody, I hate to cut this off, but we got less than a minute here. Like we have to do them every half hour or so, but yeah, we try and keep it in and around an hour. But it was great conversation. I kind of want to have you guys back on, or
Need to
maybe
do a
even
part two.
individually. Yeah, we definitely need to do a part two of this. Want to
Great to
talk
meet
more
you
about
all.
your projects and everything like that, but I'll post some links in the edit so we can so the our dozens and dozens of fans can introduce themselves to you and get to know your work and stuff like that.
Right on.
All right, thank you so much for coming on, guys.
Thanks for having
Yeah,
us.
this was
have a good night,
awesome.
You too,
Thanks, Joe.
thank you.
You are so odd.